Good afternoon. Optus CEO Kelly Bayer-Rosmarin has resigned from the embattled telco. Bayer-Rosmarin, who's been in the role since the start of the pandemic, has been under intense scrutiny over the past 2 weeks after a network-wide outage. She faced a grilling in Parliament on Friday but dodged questions about her resignation. In a statement, Bayer-Rosmarin said her resignation was in the best interest of Optus, adding, "It's been an honour and privilege to lead the team at Optus and to serve our customers." A high-speed crash in Sydney's south has ended with 4 young people in hospital and traffic chaos for commuters. As Alex Heinke explains, an investigation is now underway.
Although it's early on in this crash investigation, one thing is clear. Speed was a factor when this morning a Toyota Prado lost control, flipped and eventually crashed into a set of traffic lights and a fence. When you have a look at the damage to this vehicle, it is remarkable that the 4 inside have only suffered minor injuries. It was about 2:30 this morning on King George's Road in Hurstville. That's to Sydney's south. CCTV from the street actually shows the car travelling at speed moments before the crash. Now for those inside, the driver, an 18-year-old man and 19-year-old female passenger, well, they needed to be cut free from the wreck. 2 other passengers, a 20-year-old male and a girl, just 16 years of age, well, they were able to walk free, but were taken to hospital as well, just as a precaution.
It's a quasi-drag strip a lot of the time. Mm. There's no speed mitigation at all. It's just a lot of speed here and a lot of young kids at night.
Yeah.
Sometimes people are speeding. I would prefer if something is done to the road and, you know, make it more easier for people to cross and the traffic's to be going.
This crash did cause a little bit of headaches on the roads this morning, but we'll bring you the full update in the news at 6 o'clock.
2 people have been forced to jump out of a window and onto an awning after a unit caught fire in Chatswood. Tradies nearby ran to help the residents get away from the building. 13 more were also able to get out in time. 40 firefighters and 13 fire trucks were needed to put out the blaze. No serious injuries have been reported. The federal government is facing tough questions over our relationship with Beijing after an Australian Navy diver was injured by sonar blasts from a Chinese warship. Federal politics reporter Rhys D'Alessandro with the latest.
The injury was minor, but the actions that caused it were unprofessional at best and provocative at worst. Navy divers from the HMAS Toowoomba were untangling fishing net from their ship's propellers in Japan's exclusive economic zone when they were subjected to sonar pulses from a Chinese warship. It's understood the vessel was warned there were divers in the water, its actions labelled as deliberate and dangerous. What's raising eyebrows, though, is the way in which this has been dealt with diplomatically. The incident occurred a full day before the Prime Minister left Australia to attend the APEC summit in San Francisco. There, he met briefly with the Chinese President Xi Jinping and China's Foreign Minister Wang Yi. But did he raise the incident with them directly? We haven't been able to get a straight answer from any of his senior ministers or his office. And this afternoon, the PM himself has refused to go into those details, saying in an interview he doesn't discuss private conversations and that the matter has been raised through the appropriate channels. The opposition seizing on the murkiness around that response.
This was dangerous, it was unsafe and unprofessional. The consequences of these events are that they do damage to the relationship, and this certainly is an event that does damage, and we've made that very clear.
He's boasted about the time that he spent with Xi Jinping and China's Foreign Minister Wang Yi while he was there, but did he raise this question? Well, he hasn't said so, and if he's not saying so, I fear the answer is he didn't.
The government's handling of this situation aside, this latest incident is perhaps a timely reminder. The relationship with our biggest trading partner remains a fractured one.
A driver in Sydney's West had a close call when his car seat caught on fire, the flames causing the man to swerve into a power pole on Canterbury Road in Bankstown. Firefighters were able to quickly put the fire out. The driver is okay, but his car is badly damaged. There's small blue circles that give us an insight into our state's rich history, and now 14 more blue plaques will soon appear on all kinds of buildings. For more on this, we're joined by Sam Kidman from Heritage New South Wales. Sam, thank you so much for joining us. Who and what is being remembered in this latest batch of blue plaques?
The program celebrates many
well-known people that the broader community would be really familiar with, but also brings attention to those lesser-known stories about people that have made an impact on a particular community, town or field or work of study. It encourages people to explore their local communities and find out a little bit more about where they've come from. The 14 newest plaques, the blue plaque that's being for Kathleen Butler, who was a key contributor to the construction of the Sydney Harbour Bridge. She worked really closely with Sir John Bradfield on the construction and the project planning. It really shines a light on a story that we need to know about. She made such a significant contribution to New South Wales, and in particular, the whole character of Sydney and that pathway over the bridge to northern Sydney.
And where and when can we expect these new plaques to pop up?
From January next year. Obviously, it's really important that the plaques are located in a place where they're really easily visible to the public, and that we've negotiated with the owners of the particular properties about where the plaques are going to go.
We know there are already 35 blue plaques dotted around the state. Tell me a bit about those and the history of some of those.
Well, where do I start? I can talk about Chips Rabbity and June Bronhill in Broken Hill. I'm sure your viewers are aware that June Bronhill was a very famous singer. Chips Rabbity was a seminal figure in the development of Australian cinema as an actor. Brett Whiteley, one of the most famous modernist Australian painters. He worked out of Lavender Bay. May Gibbs, of course, Snuggle Pot and Cuddle Pie. She was a famous children's author and artist, and her books really contribute to the fabric of the Australian community and our history. The plaques are all over New South Wales, whether it be Wagga Wagga, Albury, Grafton, Sydney, North Shore, Neutral Bay.
Just how important do you believe these plaques are, and can we expect to see some more of them appearing across the city or across the state?
We're just doing some planning now for the next nominations round. We really want to ensure that we get as diverse a representation as possible for the Blue Plaques program. It's fantastic to recognise these achievements and really shine a light on them.
Yeah, I always enjoy walking along and seeing some of those plaques and learning a little bit about the history of that place or the person that lived there. So, Sam Kidman, thank you so much for your time.
It's an absolute pleasure. Thanks for your interest.
Let's have a quick check of the weather right now. It's 22 degrees at Sydney Harbour, 27 in Penrith. Looking ahead to tomorrow, a possible shower for Sydney, 26. Heavy rain for Brisbane, 25. The chance of a storm for Canberra, 26. Showers for Melbourne, 19. Partly cloudy in Adelaide, 24. And hot and sunny in Perth, 36. And Amber will be here with the full forecast a little later. Heavy rain from a tropical storm has turned deadly in the Dominican Republic after flooding caused a highway wall to collapse. 9 people have been killed, with thousands more displaced across 8 of the country's provinces.